You know, I just said New World Order. Now, there's a phrase that a lot of folks, that you hear that, you think of kookery. You think of conspiracy theorists. And for a long time, I did too, actually. But I'll never forget when it was George Bush Sr. who stood in front of the microphone on national television and said, we have achieved, or talked about achieving, coming into, out of his own mouth, he said, the New World Order. What's really funny is that for so long now, if you mention globalism or New World Order, most people just roll their eyes and say, you've been listening to too many conspiracy theorists. However, I want to share with you the way that Chuck Baldwin words it in an article, which you can find online, called, the title of the article is called The Contest Is On by Chuck Baldwin. And he talks about this the push of globalism and the rise of nationalism that's taking place. Apparently, it's a global movement. And, you know, as I said, most people thought that New World Order and globalism were fringe conspiracy theorist ideas, but now it's a very rare, you're really very ignorant if you're not aware of the fact that that is actually what's been going on all this time. The media had denied it, most public officials and political leaders had denied it, and yet in the background it's exactly what they were working for. The modern push towards Chuck Baldwin wrote about it. He says, the modern push toward globalism has been actively taking place since the creation of the United Nations back in 1945. For the first few decades following the advent of the UN, globalists mostly hid and denied their efforts. Political and economic leaders seldom mentioned it in public. George H.W. Bush, and I've talked about this many times before right here at this radio station. You may remember my message last year on the rise of the beast and the identity of the Antichrist. And I mentioned, I did a little skit just kind of making fun of the New World Order. But I also talked about the facts behind all of that. And George H.W. Bush, that's George Bush Sr., and his statements he made on national television during what they call the Operation Desert Storm during the Gulf Wars, when Saddam Hussein had invaded Kuwait, and all the political leaders and leaders of the various nations around that area all got together and agreed that they were going to oust him. And so he says, political and economic leaders seldom mentioned it in public. George H.W. Bush was the first Western leader to talk openly about a burgeoning New World Order. Since then, leaders around the world have been very open about their desire to create global government. Today, only ignoramuses or bald-faced liars deny the existence of the globalist agenda. You would have to be really willfully ignorant to deny it, because you hear him talk about it all the time. It's every other breath out of Barack Obama. The global community, the global government, on and on and on. Mainly they use the phrase global community, world community, like as if we're all a community. Well, that's where communism comes from, okay? George H.W. Bush said, we have, this is what he was saying right there on national television. And I remember sitting there watching it and thinking to myself, what in the world is wrong with this guy? And he said, quote, we have before us the opportunity to forge for ourselves and for future generations a new world order. When we are successful, and we will be, we have a real chance at this new world order. An order in which a credible United Nations can use its peacekeeping role to fulfill the promise and vision of the UN's founders. Bush Sr. also said, quote, what is at stake is more than one small country. It is a big idea, a new world order. He further said, quote, the world can, therefore, seize the opportunity to fulfill the long-held promise of a new world order. And then he went on to say, quote, it is the sacred principles. Now listen to this. George H.W. Bush, 1991. It is, quote, the sacred principles enshrined in the United Nations Charter, to which the American people will henceforth pledge their allegiance. I remember it all too well. And at the time, I was too young and dumb to really think, what exactly? All I knew was something is not right about this. And I sat there and I thought, what is wrong with this guy? But I didn't understand when he said, the American people will henceforth pledge their allegiance to what? The United Nations Charter. You know, it should dawn on every American that, hey, we have a constitution. Hey, we have a Bill of Rights. Hey, we have sovereign states. And each of the states have constitutions and laws. We don't owe any allegiance to any world body other than to try to get along with our neighbors. And so for him to pledge the allegiance of the American people to the United Nations Charter was way out there. Now, he's a Republican, so, you know, maybe I'm making a lot of the Democrats out there happy, but, you know, what are the Democrats talking about today? It's always about our commitment to the world community, our commitment to the global community and environmentalism, and the human rights issues, by the way, none of which have gotten better. None of the human rights violations committed by any of these nations we've been trying to rein in, or they've been trying to rein in all these years with this global community jazz, none of those human rights violations have gotten any better. They've only gotten worse. And they continue to get worse. And we continue to have war. We continue to have warlords springing up all over the Middle East out there. Because that is the rise of the beast, as I talked about before. It's not a conspiracy theory. It's not some, you know, fringe loony idea. It's a fact. It's a reality which you may not want to come to terms with. And you know, a lot of folks will choose not to think about these things because it draws you out of a place of comfort and puts you in an area where you may not feel, you may feel a little uncomfortable with this whole idea and a little bit out of control. That won't make it go away. It is time for us to be men across this nation and stand up and face the reality of what we've been allowing to happen in this nation under God and to take back our country. That's not some hidden, you know, take America back, make America great again. That's not some code phrase. That's not some hidden agenda. America was the greatest nation on earth. Not because we pushed people around, but because we were a free nation under God. This is the nation that fought wars where, hey, lots and lots of white guys gave their lives to set black folks free from slavery, and rightfully so. This is the only nation that fought a war to abolish slavery, paid with their blood. This is the only nation that recognizes in our declaration that you have a God-given, inalienable right to live free, and to live free to pursue that which brings fulfillment into your life. Life, liberty, and the pursuit of happiness. Ideals which the Founding Fathers considered to be self-evident. They called it the natural law. But on this subject of globalism, Tony Blair said, he was England's former Prime Minister at the time during the Bush administration. We are all internationalists now, whether we like it or not. He continued saying, on the eve of a new millennium, we are now in a new world. We need new rules for international cooperation and new ways of organizing our international institutions. Today, the impulse towards interdependence is immeasurably greater. That's a bad impulse. Can I just say? We don't need to be dependent on other countries. Just like you as an individual don't need to be making yourself dependent on the government or anybody else's good graces. If they want to be kind and generous to you, then that's a good thing for them to do. But you don't want to put yourself in a position of dependence upon that. You will find your life wrecked. We will find our nation wrecked the more we place ourselves at the mercy of a body of people somewhere else in the world who have no idea what the God-given rights of life, liberty, and the pursuit of happiness is all about. We'll be losing everything we've got if we do that. Tony Blair goes on and says, globalization has transformed our economies and our working practices. Yeah, it's transformed them, all right. We're giving away jobs to these other countries in the hopes that they'll, you know, be nice. And what do? Well, we give them jobs. You know, we stop manufacturing stuff here so that they can manufacture it over there. So we give away jobs. We give away money. We got foreign aid and, you know, billions and billions, hundreds of thousands of billions of dollars going to all these other countries. We send our young men over there to fight their wars for them, give their lives on their soil, wars which they themselves don't have the will or the character to stand up and fight. Then we've given all of this, and then they turn around and say, forget you, America, we're going to do what we want to do. Has it been worth it? No, it hasn't. And it's time for it to stop. I got a quote here from Walter Cronkite. He's in an interview, and this is what he's in, and also in his book, he wrote a book called A Reporter's Life, and he talks a lot about, you know, how they influence the culture. Yeah, you know, instead of just reporting facts and being unbiased, you really have to have your head in the sand not to recognize that they endeavor on a daily basis through mass media, through the mainstream or lamestream media, as Palin calls it, to influence people's thinking, to influence how we vote, to influence our society and mold it to fit the globalist agenda. They've been doing that for a long time now. And Cronkite admits it in A Reporter's Life. And here's what he says. A system, quote, Walter Cronkite, quote, a system of world order, preferably a system of world government, is mandatory. Oh, thank you, genius. Where would we be without your brilliant input? None of the rest of us are capable of thinking for ourselves. It's mandatory that we submit to a world... You see this? Ugh. The proud nations, he goes on to say, quote, the proud nations someday will see the light and, for the common good and their own survival, yield up their precious sovereignty. Cronkite told BBC newsman Tim Sebastian, quote, I think we are realizing that we are going to have an international rule of law. He added, quote, we need not only an executive to make international law, so we need a world president, but we need the military forces to enforce that law. So we also need an army of the world that will come to America and fight against us if we don't obey the new laws that the world president came up to. Hey, people! This is right out of science fiction, but it ain't science fiction. They're talking this nonsense and been talking it for the last 60 years, or 70. He goes on to say, the American people are going to begin to realize that perhaps they are going to have to yield some sovereignty to an international body to enforce world law. On and on it goes. He talks about how that we then created the Federal Bank, and how that has been one of the strongest tools and of the corruption of our nation and of our politics and of national policy and foreign policy. He goes on to talk about the creation of various foreign policy organizations and membership in them by elitists, and he even has a list here of people who are members of the Commission on Foreign Relations and the Trilateral Commission. Both are not elected. You know, these are not bodies of elected representatives, okay? These are people who get in there because they're elitists, and they get appointed or they work their way in through their influence. But these bodies have been very powerful in influencing our foreign policy, and indeed foreign policy of the whole world. And he gives a list of people who are members of these groups. George Herbert Walker Bush, Bill Clinton, Sandra Day O'Connor, Dick Cheney, Les Aspin, Colin Powell, Robert Gates, Brent Shawcross, Jesse Jackson, Mario Cuomo, Dan Rather, Tom Brokaw, David Brinkley. On and on it goes. John McCain, George McGovern, Michael Dukakis, Al Gore, John Kerry, Barack Obama, on and on. Yeah, you know, why would our president put himself in a compromising position like that? Tom Daschle, Janet Napolitano, and last but not least on this list, Hillary Clinton. You know, there's a person who's conspicuously not on this list, and I'll leave that for you to figure out who that is, okay? I'll try to hold back my enthusiasm just a little bit. But it's absolutely essential, folks, that we stop looking at potential leaders as either Democrats or Republicans, or as conservatives or liberals. Those monikers mean very little today. We must start identifying people as either Americans or globalists. And when we're talking about electing them and appointing them into positions of authority and power over this country, over our laws, over policy that will govern our lives, we need to get with the program. We need to get with what's really going on in reality in our nation today and indeed in this world. The fact of the matter is they are either patriotic Americans or they are globalists, and I don't believe for a second that a globalist can be a patriotic American, because it is a very straight out conflict of interests. Period. So we need to identify them either as Americans or globalists. Either they believe in an independent, sovereign, self-governing United States of America, you know, where we have actual borders, where we have actual control over who we're allowing to come in here and kill us or bring drugs, you know? Gee, wouldn't that be a novel idea? Where we actually have a strong military? Where we actually manufacture things again and have real jobs that are good paying jobs? You know, we need to decide on that. Or the alternative is we can be a supranational government and internationalism. Either they believe in devotion to the U.S. Constitution, Bill of Rights, and Declaration of Independence, or they believe in the goals and objectives of the United Nations. That is a big question, isn't it? I've got some statements made here by various world leaders. One of the most interesting ones that I've got here and I want to read to you is by Chester M. Pierce. And he was pretty much head of education for a long time. And this is a statement that he made. Every child, listen to this, quote, every child in America entering school at the age of five. Now remember, this guy's PhD and he's in charge of public education policy, okay? Or is very strongly influencing it. I mean, get this. He says, every child in America entering school at the age of five is mentally ill. Did you think your five-year-old was mentally ill? Well, according to the expert, she is. Is mentally ill because he comes to school. Here's why. Because he comes to school with certain allegiances to our founding fathers, toward our elected officials, toward his parents, toward a belief in a supernatural being, and toward the sovereignty of this nation as a separate and sovereign entity. Now, it's funny, he's talking about five-year-olds in that way. They don't think on that level at this point in their life. They wouldn't even know what you mean by sovereignty, okay? But these ideals are alive in the heart and mind of a five-year-old, if they've been raised right in their home and they've had any exposure whatsoever to an intelligent culture, especially a Christian culture, then, yeah, these truths are alive and well in their hearts and minds, even though they wouldn't put it in these words. He puts it in these words because he knows what he's talking about. And he knows that the agenda is to drive that from their minds. And so he says, quote, it's up to you as teachers to make all these sick children well by creating the international child of the future. Wow. What's really funny to me is that so many people refuse to pull their head out of the sand and see what's going on and face this thing. Well, let's take a look at the founders of this country and what they had to say about the principles upon which our nation and laws were made. I have a long listing of quotations from founding fathers of our nation. Samuel Adams, signer of the Declaration of Independence. said, we have this day, talking about the 4th of July when they signed the Declaration, he said, we have this day restored the sovereign to whom all men ought to be obedient. He reigns in heaven, and from the rising to the setting of the sun, let his kingdom come. Now that's how one founding father perceived the establishment of this country as a free and independent nation. Fascinating point of view in comparison to how our politicians view it today. What about George Washington? You know, he said, it is the duty of all nations to acknowledge the providence of Almighty God, to obey His will, to be grateful for His benefits, and humbly to implore His protection and favor. Of all the dispositions and habits which lead to political prosperity, religion, now he was speaking of the Christian religion, of that there is no doubt, religion and morality are indispensable. And he said, true religion, which is Christianity, affords to government its surest support. That's right. You have a more stable government when it is established and supported by Christian people. That's why America's Constitution has outlasted any other constitution in the world. Because it was founded and established and written by Christian people. But they've been trying very hard over the last 75 years to tear that down. To make you forget that simple fact of history, that this nation was founded on Christian principles. The United States Congress endorsed the Bible and God. Congress printed a Bible. Did you know that the first printing press that they had here in America was set up by the United States Congress, and the first thing they did on it was print Bibles? And they made a proclamation when they did so in 1782, still a very young nation, lest there be any doubt about our founding in Christian principles and biblical principles. And they said in their statement, the United States in Congress assembled recommends this edition of the Bible to the inhabitants of the United States, a neat edition of the Holy Scripture for the use in schools. So they even recommended that it be used in schools. And they went on to say, they passed this resolution, the Congress of the United States recommends and approves the Holy Bible for use in all schools. United States Congress, 1782. In God We Trust became our national motto, 1864, United States Congress. John Adams, President of the United States of America, first Vice President, signer of the Declaration of Independence, signer of the Bill of Rights, and signer of the First Amendment, said the Declaration of Independence laid the cornerstone of human government upon the first precepts of Christianity. Let me read that again. Founding Father here, John Adams. The Declaration of Independence laid the cornerstone of human government upon the first precepts of Christianity. What might those first precepts have been, pray tell? Well, I have here with me today, I keep a copy on my cell phone. There's an app for that, you know. The Constitution of the United States, and it also has in it a copy of the Declaration of Independence. And in the Declaration of Independence, there are some principles set forth. Number one is called the laws of nature and of nature's law, the natural law. In other words, or of nature's God, rather. So in other words, he's saying that it is written within the hearts of mankind, a natural law that came down to us through God, the creator of all the natural realm. Then also the other principles are that of inalienable rights endowed upon man by their Creator. Among these are life, liberty, and the pursuit of happiness. So that's what he's talking about, Christian precepts. Okay? And he goes on to say, the general principles on which the fathers achieved independence were the general principles of Christianity. I will avow that I then believed, talking about when he signed the Declaration and Constitution, he said, I will avow that I then believed and now believe that those general principles of Christianity are as eternal and immutable as the existence and attributes of God Himself. The highest glory of the American Revolution, he says, was this. It connected, in one indissoluble bond, the principles of civil government and the principles of Christianity. Well, who else have we got here? We got Patrick Henry, early American leader. He says, there is a book called the Bible, and it's worth more than all other books ever printed. It cannot be, he says, emphasized too strongly or too often that this great nation was founded not by religionists, but by Christians. Not on religions, but on the gospel of Jesus Christ. That's Patrick Henry. Now, John Jay, first Chief Justice of the U.S. Supreme Court, says, Providence has given to our people the choice of their rulers, and it is their duty, as well as privilege and interest of our Christian nation, to select and prefer Christians for their rulers. Huh. First Supreme Court Justice said that. Overall, outright admission that this is a Christian nation, and that the people of this nation ought to, you know, elect Christians for leaders, that it wouldn't be unreasonable to do so. Since it's a Christian nation. Huh. John Hancock. And he said that all may bow to the scepter of our Lord Jesus Christ, and that the whole earth may be filled with His glory. We all know the signature of John Hancock. We still use that phrase. Put your John Hancock on the dotted line, you know. He's got the one with that big signature on the Declaration of Independence. And he said, we recognize no sovereign but God, and no king but Jesus. Who's king of the United States of America? Well, according to the Founding Fathers, the king of America is Jesus. Well, I wish I could really feel confident that that were true. But as we look at our nation today, we know that there's been a very, very, very concerted effort down through the years to dethrone the Prince of Peace. And as a result, we're seeing less and less peace in our nation today. Benjamin Rush said Christianity is the only true and perfect religion. John Witherspoon, signer of the Declaration of Independence and Continental Congress, he is the best friend to American liberty. John Witherspoon, he is the best friend to American liberty, who is most sincere in and active in promoting true and undefiled religion, and who sets himself with the greatest firmness to bear down on profanity and immorality of every kind. Whoever is an avowed enemy of God, I suggest, is an avowed enemy of his country. Whew, that's pretty strong language. I'm inclined to wholeheartedly agree. Benjamin Franklin put it like this, rebellion to tyrants is obedience to God. Thomas Jefferson put it like this. Now, we all know Thomas Jefferson. And he said, quote, God, who gave us life, gave us liberty. Can the liberties of a nation be secure when we have removed a conviction that these liberties are the gift of God? Good question. And he says, I tremble for my country when I reflect that God is just and that His justice will not sleep forever. That's a warning from an early founder of this nation that we can fall under the judgment of God if we forget that liberty is a gift of God. And he goes on to say, the Christian religion is the best religion that's ever been given to man. Eh. Daniel Webster says, education is useless without the Bible. Noah Webster, who is called the schoolmaster of our republic, he said it like this, education is useless without the Bible. The Bible was America's basic textbook in all fields. Now, there's a forgotten fact of our history. There was a time in our institutions of higher learning when theology was considered the queen of the sciences. That was the day when they could have unity out of diversity, because they could unify around Jesus Christ. Not so today, because He's been evicted from the public education square. And as a result, we see a great deal of disunity and disharmony, and a lot of talk about diversity. And diversity will not bring unity, and diversity will not bring peace and harmony, but it will bring conflict, as we are seeing is happening before our very eyes. But Noah Webster tried to remind Americans to stay on track with keeping the Bible, God's Word, at center stage in our effort to be an educated and wise people. And he said, "The Bible was America's basic textbook in all fields. God's Word contained in the Bible has furnished all necessary rules to direct our conduct." Noah Webster also said in the preface of Noah Webster's Dictionary of 1828, they've long since removed that, but he said, "In my view, the Christian religion is the most important and one of the first things in which all children under a free government ought to be instructed. No truth is more evident to my mind than that the Christian religion must be the basis of any government intended to secure the rights and privileges of a free people." Well, there are so many good quotes here, I could go on and on.
But we've run out of time here at the Voice of Hope. Have a wonderful Independence Day, God bless, and goodbye.